captive free. You came to bring us liberty. My sin and my rejection, your burden and my acceptance. Now I'm alive. We'll be right back.
Sarah, and I'm the executive assistant here at FWC, and we just wanted to take a moment to welcome all of our first-time guests. You are so important to us, and we are so excited that you are here today. And right now, there is a brochure located in the chair pocket right in front of you. If you wouldn't mind taking a minute to fill that out, because we would love to hear about your experience today. And you can do one of two things with that. You can either drop it off in the offering bucket on its way by, or on your way out, you can drop it off at our welcome center located in the lobby. There are people out there who want to meet you, they have a free gift for you, and they just want to get to know you. But right now, let's all leave our seats. Let's go greet two or three people, and let's welcome them to church.
Church. I'm Dee Dee.
And I'm Gabe. Whether this is your first time at FWC or you've been attending for years, we are so glad to have you here.
If you have any questions or like more information about our church, we would love to meet you at our Welcome Center in the lobby.
Here are some exciting events that are happening at FWC.
Pastor's new series, Inspired, is now in session. You don't want to miss this series of messages on being guided by the Holy Spirit.
The bookstore sale is now in progress, so visit the FWC bookstore and browse a great selection of 40% marked off items. We know these materials will help transform your life and bring encouragement to you as you walk with Christ.
Dinner and community is this Wednesday, September 2nd. Come enjoy dinner and be a part of our small group communities where biblical topics are openly discussed in a friendly and welcoming environment. Everyone is welcome.
21 Days of Prayer will begin Sunday, September 6th through Sunday, September 27th. So mark your calendar now to set time aside to join us here at FWC for this special season of prayer. Prayer schedules are available in the lobby.
Children's water baptism will be Sunday, September 6th during service. Children who would like to be water baptized must be in second grade and up and have received teaching and instruction on water baptism in Power Kids or Surge.
Momentum is Sunday, September 6th at 6 p.m. Get ready for this special one-night event where the Aftershock Youth, grades 7th through 12th, will unite to seek God before the upcoming school year.
AMP Sub 30 After Party is Wednesday, September 16th. Just because the service ends doesn't mean the party has to stop. Come join the after party happening once a month after Wednesday community huddles in the Aftershock Cafe. To sign up for events, visit a kiosk in the lobby.
We'd like everyone to enjoy their worship experience today. So unless it's urgent, please remain at your seat until worship begins.
For updates and announcements, follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter at FWC DC. And make sure to check out our weekly event guide.
Thanks again for joining us, and enjoy the rest of the service.
Okay, you can do this, Brad. Just do like the guy said, don't make a scene, be quick. You're in, you're out. No one's gonna notice.
Good morning.
What?
I said everything okay, sir?
Get it together, man. You can do this. Wait, is he looking at me? Why is he looking at me?
Hey, man. Can I use that for a second?
What?
Your pin.
Oh, the pin. Can't back out now, man. Just do it.
How can I help you?
Just need to make a deposit.
Okay.
A mistake. I'm unarmed,
sir. I'm gonna have to ask you to quiet down.
No, it was just an invitation to church.
Calm down, sir. I will tase you.
We're having a potluck.
Inviting someone to church doesn't have to be like robbing a bank. Just ask.
How many of you have ever experienced that, inviting someone to church? This was a video to show us exactly how not to invite someone to church. We want to let you know that on September 20th, across the nation, there is going to be a movement called Back to Church Sunday. Just like this week is Back to School Week, we're going to this month celebrate Back to Church Sunday, and we want you to be an inviter, okay? We want everyone in the church to make up their mind. Right now, we're giving you plenty of advance notice to be an inviter. Tell somebody next to you, say, be an inviter on September 20th. Tell them, say, be an inviter on September 20th. Of course, that all begins before September 20th. We're not even into the month yet, so we're giving you plenty of time ahead, and we're going to have a special program on that day based on inviting people to church, okay? We don't want anybody dressing up and robbing banks, but we do want you to go love on people, all right, and invite them to church. How many of you have been to one of our tailgate parties this summer? Have they been a lot of fun or what?
Yes.
We are going to that Sunday, rather than doing our tailgate party on a Wednesday night, we're going to have a tailgate party, but we're going to call it a back to church party after that Sunday morning service in the parking lot. So we'll be serving hamburgers and hot dogs and chicken and all the spread that we've had before. We're going to have all sorts of special things for the children, and it's going to be a great time. The difference is we won't be doing it at sundown. We'll be doing it at noon. And so we really want you to really consider the fact that the fall is a great opportunity. People start settling back down. They get back in school. You know, how have you seen that commercial concerning school where the parents are singing, it's the most wonderful time of the year? None of you seen that? Because finally we get our brains back and we don't have to be separated and the kids aren't running around doing certain things. I was sharing that we have an opportunity here at Family Worship Center, which is really a great opportunity, to help the court system that whenever these teenagers get in trouble and they have to go serve hours, instead of putting them in jail, of course, they make them serve hours for some of the vandalism and some of the things that they do when they get in trouble. We are one of the locations that these teenagers come and serve their hours. And I want you to know how much of a blessing this church is to those teenagers. A lot of those young people end up starting going to church here because they come and serve hours here, and my team work with them so close. I mean, of all the places on earth that you could serve hours, how many of you know FWC would be a great place if you need a turn in your life, right? Well, these are the things that go on during the summer. I think that's why it's the most wonderful time of the year. They don't have enough time to get into trouble. And I don't want you to think that we pray for those young people to get in trouble, because we love the free labor. It's great having them here, but when they get back in school, they get a little more focused. Well, what is the purpose? It's focus. We want you to realize that people are getting a little more focused. They're settling back into their routine. Before they get stuck in their routine, let's make church part of their routine, right? And so there are people that have been to church that aren't going to church anymore, but there are also people who have never been to church. I am in shock sometimes when I talk to people, because I talk to people all week long, all year long, and when people tell me they've never been to church, and then I'll research, I'll say, well, did your parents go to church? And I have people tell me that their parents never went to church, and they never took them to church. And usually when you get back a generation, they'll start saying, well, my grandmother or my grandfather went to church, or I knew an aunt or an uncle. But it is shocking to me that in America, that there are people that have never been to church. And I think that we should be a team effort to invite as many people as possible. I read a statistic that I believe that this is correct, that there are 200,000 seats in the Washington, D.C. area that make up all the churches. And there's over 6 million people around the Beltway. So when we say we don't have a very big pond to fish in, I think we're mistaken. Come on. There's not enough churches. There are not enough seats in the churches. If one morning everyone in Washington, D.C. decided to go to church, it wouldn't even be possible for the churches to hold just a little teeny percentage of them. So there's no reason why we can't invite our neighbor and get him in church. How many of you know somebody that needs to be with you here today? Come on, how many of you, come on, be honest. You need to believe for them. God, give them to me. Let them come to church like I did. Every one of you had to walk through the door the first time.
Right.
You had to make a decision to come. And once you came, you saw how beautiful my wife was. You came back. Well, something like that. Anyway, September 20th, be an inviter, and we're going to have a great time afterwards, so it'll be a good time for them to fellowship. Then back to church outreach. That's September 20th on September 19th. The day before, which would be Saturday, like yesterday, we're going to have an outreach where we all meet here at the church and we go out into different locations. We've been doing this now for 2 years, going out into the community, reaching people, talking to them about Jesus, just telling them that God loves them and he has a plan for their life. When you tell somebody God loves you and he has a plan for your life, they have to decide whether they believe that or not. You're not forcing anything on them. We give them a gift, just a small little token of our appreciation to be able to talk to them with no strings attached. How many of you have been a part of our outreaches? Will you please raise your hand up? Has it been a good time? It's awesome to go out and share your faith. If you've never been a part of one of our outreaches, just break the seal, break the mold. Come on out, and I know it can be a little nerve-wracking to go up and speak to somebody directly, but you know the Bible says we're supposed to be a witness for Christ. There's no secret service in the church, all right? It's open and spoken, come on. And so we want you to be a part of that. We will do that on September 19th, the Saturday before this Sunday, so that we can invite people to come to our Back to Church Sunday, and it'll be a great opportunity for you to be a part of that. We have church on Saturday night. What a great thing to walk up to somebody, just give them a gift, tell them God has a plan for their life, see if it opens communication. If it doesn't, just say thank you, God bless you, have a great day. But to be able to tell them, hey, if you're not doing anything at 5 o'clock this afternoon, why don't you come check our church out? We have had people come to church a couple hours later from inviting them in a parking lot. Those are pretty great results, right? So we want you to be a part of that. So mark those two dates down on your calendar. You also heard on the video about 21 days of prayer. How many of you have participated in our month-long prayer meetings? Have they been awesome or what? Let me say something to you. Prayer changes things. And the number one thing prayer changes is you. It changes me. You know, like exercise. I don't know if you know exercise will change some things. It'll do two things. First, it'll give you a bad attitude because you don't want to do it, especially at my age. Second thing it'll do is it'll begin to shape your body, won't it? And how many of you know exercise? You want to do it when you start seeing results. Prayer is the same thing. Prayer is an exercise. It requires you to have spiritual exercise. A lot of people don't get excited about prayer just like they don't get excited about exercising. But I want you to know that just like exercising, when you stick with it, will change your physique, change your heart, change your internals, so will prayer. So we're going to have 21 days of consistent prayer beginning September 6th through September 27th. We've made up a little information card for you to pick up out there in the lobby. Please grab that information card. You can put this on the dash of your car. You can put it on your refrigerator, on your mirror. but put it somewhere right in front of you so you will not forget about these 21 days of prayer. Also on here is a schedule that tells you when we will be praying, because we'll be praying at different times. During the week, we'll be praying on Saturday and Sunday. There's different opportunities. And then Wednesday night, we have our regular scheduled service, so we'll also be including prayer with dinner and community. We want to remind you about that. 21 days of prayer beginning September 6th. Then, Heart for the House. We are right now in the middle of raising some money to offset the maintenance on the buses. The buses have been an absolute blessing. We're coming up on 10 years of owning these buses. They have always, always gotten us to our destination. They've been to New York. They've been to Pennsylvania. They've been all the way down south to Florida. They have been out west. They have been to all these different locations, besides all of the runs they make locally to all the different events that we do locally. On a weekly basis, they run up and down the road. We go and pick people up down in D.C. When Rodney Howard Brown was here and he had that meeting down in Washington, D.C., they used our buses as a location. People could come here, park their cars, get on our buses, drive down, and not have to bring all that extra traffic downtown. They were so appreciative of when we did that, but we couldn't have done it if we didn't have the buses. And so the buses have been a great blessing, but they also are an expense. They are not, it's like your car. I don't know if you know, the minute you drive your car off the lot, it loses value, right? Unless you own a Lamborghini or something like that. And if you do, I want to ride. I want to ride today. They lose their value, so they have to be maintained. How many of you maintain your cars? Come on, this is an opportunity to, I maintain. How many of you wish you didn't have to? Not put tire. How do you wish your tires were run forever tires? Run forever brakes. Run forever oil. All the things that you have to change in your car. It's the same way with the buses. They're just a lot more expensive. So we're raising $30,000 to offset the expenses. After 10 years of maintenance, $30,000 is not that much money. So we appreciate everyone who's given. We're up to $8,700. We said we were going to do that through the month of August. We kind of started a week into August late. We're going to take this over into September because I'm believing every dime will come in. We already have another project that we're going to be presenting to you, but we don't want to present that project to you. And I'll just give you a little hint about the next project. You coffee lovers are going to really going to contribute towards that one. And all the drug addicts said amen. So that'll be our next project, but let's get this one taken care of. I'm really excited about all of the things that we have for the future. Top volunteer needs. That is a card that's right in front of you in your chair pocket. These are called top volunteer needs because we need people to volunteer. Listen, you might be new to Family Worship Center. You may have attended here for a year. You may have been here 5 years. The best way to feel a part of your church is to volunteer. This is how you become a part of this congregation. The other way to be a part of this church is to come on a Wednesday night and be a part of our small groups, where we break the church down into smaller groups where you can get to know each other. I'm believing that this fall is going to be the biggest influx of people into Family Worship Center we have ever seen in the history of the church. We have made a lot of changes. We have done a lot of things to reach out into the community and bring people in to make our place a place where you can bring your friend, your neighbor, your boss, your coworker, your relative, who might have been turned off by church in the past, but we want to turn them on to church. And once they get turned on, they need to become a part of it. And one of the things that is not written on that list, I think there's about 8 things on there that you can look at, but one of the things that has been written in there by my executive assistant, didn't she do a great job opening this service, huh? She did such an awesome job. The reason that I'm up here is Pastor Tony is on vacation, and she was filling in for Melissa, but she did such a great job. I think we're going to be hearing more from her as well, all right? I want to use as many of my team members as possible. I don't even like to be up here right now. This is why I have Pastor Tony doing it. But it says Music Dinner Team written in Sarah's handwriting on there. Next week, that will be part of this list. I'm believing that all of these things are going to get filled up real quickly. We only need a few people to volunteer in these areas. If you will please, please say, I will help in one of these areas. We're not going to overwork you. We have schedules. We have other people that are involved. We just want you to be a part of the team, right? Did you ever hear about the little bits? Mama and Papa little bit, and the four little bits? And they had all this work to do on this farm, and they thought, somebody asked them, how do you get all of this work done? And the mama said, every little bit helps. Okay? So we need you to jump in and be a part. The music dinner team. What is the music dinner team? How many of you love our band? Come on, put some lights up here, Gabe. Come on, let's. How many of you think they do a great job? I'm just going to take a quick minute and introduce the band to you. How many of you would like to know who the band is? This is my daughter, Victoria. Her name is Tori, and she just graduated from Oral Roberts University with a music degree, and she has just recently taken over the music department of Family Worship Center, so she is 22 and has a lot on her shoulders. She's a songwriter, she's a musician, and she leads the band. This is my nephew. His name is Brian. He's a keyboard player, and his dad is the executive pastor of the church, and his dad is on vacation right now. He didn't invite you? Oh, okay, well, we're glad you're in church. He's a great keyboard player. The singers, why don't you guys introduce yourselves real quick? Just tell them your name so I don't have to run down here.
Hi, my name is Jenny Jewell.
Becky Seyfried.
I'm Karen Contreras.
Crystal Garcia.
And so we have other singers as well that are a part of the team, but these are the singers that are up here right now. Tony Ball, I was thinking about this group over here. And Tony Ball is an awesome bass player. He's been up and down the East Coast. He's lived here, he's lived down south, he's lived here, he's lived down south, he's lived here, he's lived down south. He lived here, he lived out west, and now he's back, and he came up to me and said, Pastor, I'm back. I said, I don't believe you. I said, you're like a woman who breaks my heart. I said, I don't believe you, but I believe you're back. I think you are back. He's an awesome bass player. We're glad to have him. He has been playing for us for a lot of years, and so it's very interesting you're back now. Don't you find that interesting? So it's wonderful having you back here. This is John Barklow, and John has been playing guitar for us since you were how old? 15 years old. So he's only 5 years, right, John? Since he's been 15 years old, he took a little break. He and his wife decided to have, you know, 13 kids, so they had to take a break musically. But he's back now. We're so glad to have you guys back on the stage, really. We're glad to have you here. And then one of our newest musicians on the stage. I'm so proud of this guy right here. What's your name again?
Chris.
Oh, yeah, Chris, that's right. Chris actually works here at the church full time. Let me tell you something about Chris. Chris has been coming here since he was a teenager. Chris has had some struggles in his life. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, sure,
he said. Sure, whatever. But let me tell you something about Chris. This kid is an absolute changed kid. If you knew him 5 years ago and you knew him today, you would be able to say, this is what you can point at to say the grace of God is mighty and powerful. And I'm so proud to have him up on this stage playing his guitar. So why am I making a big deal about the band? I have no idea. I forgot. Look, she's hiding behind that symbol. I can't even see her face. Look at her. I'll hug her. This is Caitlin. Caitlin and my daughter are our chick drummers here at Family Worship Center, and I just love the fact that we have girl drummers. Her dad also plays the guitar. Her mom also sings on stage, helps with the choir. Caitlin has been playing since she's just been a little girl, and of course, we bring these teenagers up through the youth group, and they learn to play in the youth. And then they come up, and as they progress, we're able to put them up here on the adult stage. And so she's our number one drummer right now, and she just does an awesome job. And I really appreciate the fact that she's willing to get in that hot box and play for you. Someone might say, why do you have a box? If you knew how loud those drums would be if they weren't in that box. My daughter was like, can't we take them out of the box? I said, no. Drummers want to dominate. That's just the way they are. So let's give them all a big round of applause. We love you. I'm taking up too much time. The reason that I am letting you know about the band, they rehearse every week. We have volunteers that come in here. We come in on Sundays. We come in on Saturday nights. You work on those particular days, but you do not have to rehearse. You're being a volunteer every week for 2.5 hours. They come in here. They all have jobs. Most of them, the majority of them, are volunteers. They have families, little kids, and they come in here for 2.5 hours, sometimes more than that, sometimes twice a week they come in, and they rehearse, and they work very hard. One thing we do to try to offset that we've been doing recently is we feed them dinner. they bring their kids. And so now they can come straight from work, they can come rush here, because I don't want them to have to stop at McDonald's. I mean, that will kill them. I want them to be able to come and have a little time together and bless them so that they'll feel encouraged about the fact that they're being such a blessing to us. So what is your role here? That meal, it's a catered meal. We order it from different restaurants right here locally, and then that meal is brought here to the church and set up upstairs so when they arrive, they can go up and spend about 30 minutes feeding their kids, feeding themselves, and then come down here and be able to practice. I mean, they've got to have their heads on. They can't be low on blood sugar and playing the guitar. You understand? They've got to have their heads on. And so what we would like you to do is just let us know on an offering envelope, or you could take the top volunteer card here and you could write in music dinner team and say, I'd like to be a part of helping to pick up the meal, bring it to the church, and set it up. You don't have to cook it. We just want it to be picked up. We have found it has been a lot of work on one or two people to do that week after week after week. If we spread that out over 5, 6, 10 people, you realize how easy that would be? Once a week, everybody picking up. That means once every 2 months if we have that many people that want to help. If it's 5 people, that'd be once a month on a 5 Sunday or 5 Tuesday month if we have a 5 Tuesday month. I don't know if that works out. I think it's only Sundays. But anyway, we want you to help us out in this area. All of these areas are areas that the church has no choice. And let me just say this to you that a wise man said one time who was my pastor, if the church had to pay everybody to do everything that the church had to do, the church wouldn't be here. The finances that come into the church are to pay a little nucleus of people to run the house of God. The rest of the finances is to bless. You know, we have to buy buildings, we have to pay electric bills, we have to pay insurance, we got to buy all of this stuff, there's a lot of things we have to do, maintenance on buses. That's where the tithe goes. But the leftover is not there to just build up in the bank. We're always giving and giving. Last year we gave $150,000 to world missions. Just giving. We give to local people. There are people that constantly call us up. We just got a call this week about a family, a single mom with two little kids that's living in a hotel that if we did not help them, they were going to be kicked out on the street and have nowhere to go because right now their financial condition. So we were able to pay ahead for them for a week to be able to stay in that hotel. What are they going to do in a week? I don't know, but we'll figure that out. At least we got a week to figure it out. But we constantly receive phone calls like this. It's all the time, all the time, all the time. And we want to be able to be a blessing. We can't do it without your help. We can't do it without you volunteering. And we can't do it without you giving financially. We can't buy buildings. We can't buy land. We can't buy all the equipment. If you look back there, you'll notice our digital board has been put in place. Thank God we raised $50,000 for 2 digital boards, and they're finally in place. $50,000 so that you can hear my voice. Believe me, it's loud enough without this microphone. But this is what we have to do to be able to move forward in today's technology. We just put in a new lighting system. We were having problems with our lighting. We got struck by lightning. We were having problems with the system. And so we had a company come in and put in a new digital system. And now we can control all this lighting. I'm talking about the house lights, the little round ones that come down on you. We can now control it from our phones. So it doesn't matter where we are, we can control the lighting in the sanctuary when it needs to be controlled. There's just all sorts of things that your money goes to. And we're asking you to give. But let me tell you what the Bible says. Jesus said that when you give, he causes protection to come over your finances. Protection that you wouldn't have any other way. I think the mafia copied Jesus. They go into a store and they say, hey, cough up, $250 a week and we'll protect you. Otherwise, we're going to break your arm. The difference is Jesus doesn't threaten. Jesus will let you do whatever you want to do. How many of you love that about the Lord? There's no threat, but he tells you, if you'll obey me, I promise you, I will bless you. I will take care of you. And not only that, this is the best part about God. I know I've taken a little time, but sometimes this is what has to happen. God goes ahead of you, and he makes provision before you ever arrive. How many of you like it that when God would go ahead of you, he'll see that you're going to have a need before you get there. One of the names of God is Jehovah Jireh. That term in the Hebrew means a God who goes ahead and makes provision. That means if I was to drop my $10 bill right there and I'm back here in September and there's a need coming up in October, God will put down finances for me, not because he just wants to, but because I've been obedient to him. He's protecting me. And so now as I go along in life, all of a sudden I come up on October and my washing machine starts making funny noises. Why is it making those noises? And then I call the service guy. He wants $60 to come out and look at it. He looks at it and he says, well, you know, I'm going to front you the $60 because you got to spend $300 to fix it or you can buy a new one. But the thing is God has already made provision for you. As a matter of fact, I know I'm taking a little time, but I'm going to do this anyway. Who was I talking to last night that got a car? Who was I talking to? David, is he here? Are you here, David? Come down here and give that testimony. How would you like to hear a testimony? Is it all right if I mess the service up a little bit? Let me say this to you, church. It's why they keep me off the platform. This is the reason why I'm only allowed to speak from now on, because this is what I do. Come on up here, Kevin. Run up here, David. Come on up here, buddy. Can you do this in a nutshell? You gonna jump up here? All right. By the way, David is single. Turn around, let him get a good look. All right. Sorry, Dave.
Well, a couple weeks ago, the Lord put on my heart to, the car that I was driving, to pass it on to somebody else. And the Lord just put it on my heart for a week, and I'm like, man, what am I going to do? I don't have money or anything to get another car. So, you know, I drove it for a week. I said, nope, this is not my car. So I just listened to the Lord, and I followed what he said. And, you know, Monday night I was with my mom saying, hey, well, it's a done deal. So looks like I get to use my legs and walk and take the bus. So she's like laughing about that. She's like, well, good, you followed the Lord. And I went to my mail. And I opened it up, and there was a check for $4,500 in there. And that was the exact price of the car I was going to be buying. So God is good.
So David had an Infiniti, an older Infiniti. He gave that Infiniti to someone in the church who he didn't realize their need. He just felt like he was supposed to do it. I knew the need of those people. And he gave that Infiniti, that older Infiniti, to those people. And he literally had no money, had no idea how he was going to do it. And he was going to start he literally in his heart said, I'm going to start riding the bus. But Jehovah Jireh had gone ahead of him.
Yes.
That $4,500 check that he got, he was not expecting. It was a class action suit? Is that right? It was a class action suit that he was a part of. He didn't even know he was getting the money. $4,500. He goes to work. His boss has an Infiniti, a much newer Infiniti worth way more than $4,500, and gives him that Infiniti for $4,500.
Yes.
I mean, now there are two things that can happen here. Those are the two reactions that happen in church. People get mad and jealous. God never does that for me. Or you can have this reaction. You don't love David any more than you love me, God. I'm going to obey like David, and you're going to do for me just like you did for David. That's my reaction. I'm glad for David. I get excited for David. When I see David in that car, I say, God, if you gave him that car and I'm the same way, you'll do for me the same thing you did for him. And it might not be a car that you need. Might be something else. And this is the thing. He didn't say he got an extra car. God met his need. But he met it the way God meets them. Oh.
Yes.
God meets them big. You walk away and go, wow. I mean, I got to sit in the car last night, and I'm like, this is awesome. He looked at me, and he goes, it's really fast. He just got a ticket for doing 90 miles an hour, and I told him, don't talk like that. Say it's really good. He hadn't even gone before the judge yet. I'm having to write a character letter so he won't go to jail. I'm going to put in that character letter. He got a new card. Says it's really fast, Judge. That's why we give. We give to meet all of these needs. We give so we can give to the community. We give so we can do all of these different things. But we also give because God's given you a personal promise that he's going to take care of you. Is that good news this morning? Come on, is that really good news this morning? It really is. I couldn't wait to let David share that. So, Father, we just thank you for this opportunity to receive this offering. Lord, forgive me for going so long, but you did make me the pastor. Privileges come with that position. I thank you, Lord, that the people are learning to serve. They're learning to volunteer. They're learning to give out of their finances, not because a man says something, because your Bible, the Word of God, declares to them a promise. Lord, I thank you for every person in here that you're moving on their hearts. You move on them, Lord. Don't let a man twist their arm. You move on them just like you moved on David. Son, this isn't your car anymore. You give it to so-and-so. What am I going to do, Lord? I'm God. I'll take care of you. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege to trust you. The privilege to say, I trust you, Lord. In Jesus' name, I pray over every mind, heart, and will that is submitting to you right now. In Jesus' name, I want you to say, I trust you, Lord. God bless you as you give.
We're about to enter into a short time of worship to set the atmosphere before we go to the Word. As soon as we do that, Pastor Eddie, right after the message, he's going to give you two opportunities to respond. The first one is for prayer. If you're in here and you need prayer or agreement in any situation in your life, the prayer team will be right up front here waiting for you. The second is water baptism. If you've accepted Jesus Christ into your heart, we here at Family Worship Center believe that you are forever changed and that your next step is water baptism, which is just an outward expression of what God's already done in your heart. So if you're in here today and you have never been water baptized, but you're born again, this is your time. We have people in the back that are ready to help you every step of the way. And you may even be in here and maybe you're saying, well, I've already been water baptized, but maybe you want to rededicate that commitment this morning. We would love for you to do that as well. If you need any more information about what this water baptism is all about, if you look in the seat pocket in front of you, we have a brochure that'll answer any questions you have about water baptism. If you could stand up with me right now as we begin to worship and just take a few minutes to contemplate if either of these opportunities are for you this morning.
You know, as we watch that video, it starts moving us. It starts working in our senses. God's given us five senses, and he's given us those five senses for a reason. That we can touch the world that's around us. That we can see the world that's around us. That we can hear the world around us. That we can actually taste the world around us. These five senses were given to us so that we could experience all of creation. Looking at that video, how is it that you could look at a video that shows all these wonderful creations, both mankind, the animal kingdom, all of the landscape, all of the architecture, all of that was wrapped up in that video just now. And when we look at all of that, we see some that's man-designed and some that's God-designed. But when you look at that, there's no possible way that you could say that just happened. That out of nowhere, this just happened. It just evolved to become like this. I want you to know the reason why we showed that video up front was so that you could realize that I believe, and the Bible tells us, that all of this is created by intelligent design. That there's an intellect that's involved with all of creation. And the reason why God created all of this is not to cause us to be inspired, but to work as a signpost, to work as an arrow that points us to him. Every time I see creation, whether I'm up in an airplane and I'm able to fly through beautiful blue skies and the amazing clouds, how many of you have ever been on an airplane and maybe it was raining on the ground and then you began to rise and then you broke through the clouds only for it to find out that it's beautiful? I just want to use that as a metaphor. No matter what's going on in your life, I'm telling you, God will bring you above that situation. There's always something above your situation where God is working. This is his design. But every time I break through the clouds and I look out the window, I mean, as you get older and you've done this many times, you have to remind yourself, man, this is God's creation. This is God's amazing, intelligent design. And it's not that those designs are not there to inspire you. But people will say, I looked out over this landscape and I was so inspired. I saw this particular piece of architecture, this literature that I read, or this music that I heard so inspired me. The truth is, it moved you emotionally and pointed you to the Creator. And it's only from the Creator that you could become inspired. It's only from the one who did the actual building, not the building itself. Buildings aren't amazing in themselves. It's the one who built the building that's amazing. All of the structure coming together is by design. I've never, you know, I've been a builder the majority of my life, and never one time have they ever delivered materials onto the job and they dumped them off the truck and they jumped up and put themselves together. That's never happened. As a matter of fact, the longer they sit there, the longer they wait for an intelligent design to put them together. God is pointing you and me during this new series. He's pointing us to him. And so I want to read to you my first definition of the word inspired. We talked about this last week. Inspired means this from the Webster's Dictionary. This is a recent Webster's Dictionary. It means aroused or animated with the spirit to do something, as if by a supernatural or divine influence. Now, when I was preparing for this series, and it's been something that's been working in me for actually about 2 months, this particular series, the subject upon which I am leading into, I have preached for years. I have spoken about my entire life. As a matter of fact, this is the subject that I live my life by. This is what has gotten me what little bit of ground I've gained in life. This has been the way that I have done it. I did not realize that this word inspired was so entangled with God. But you look it up in the Webster's Dictionary, and instantly it points you to a supernatural, divine influence. The very word itself comes from a spiritual term, to be inspired. We learned over in Job chapter 32 that there was a young man named Elihu, and he said this, "I've been taught that there is a spirit inside all men." You see, men have no problem saying we have senses. Men have no problem saying we have a mind, that we have a will, and we have emotion. And what have we just described? Two parts of man. We've described the outward part that we can see, and we've described the inward part, which is the mind, will, and emotions, which we cannot see. But as psychologists and sociologists began to dig deeper into the psyche to find out more about man, they found a place that they termed conscience. And so they didn't know what to call it, because there was something that was beyond just what we could see. There was something that was beyond your will, beyond your emotions, beyond your ability to touch things and feel things and see things. There was something else on the inside of man they couldn't describe. So they described it as your conscience. And I would say that everybody is aware of their conscience. But what they did not term it is what it really is, and what the Bible calls it, it is your spirit man. It is the eternal spirit that God has placed on the inside of you. If you go back to the beginning, the Bible says in Genesis, the word Genesis means beginnings. If you go back to the book of Genesis, it says in the book of Genesis that God created man in his image. And if you go over into John, it says, into the New Testament, it says God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit. So we can't just be a body, and we can't just be a mind, we can't just be a will, and we can't just be emotions. There's got to be something else. Psychiatrists have found it, they've called it conscience, but God has always said, you're just like me from the beginning, you are a spirit being first. It is with the spirit that God begins to influence us. And here we have a young man, Elihu, back in the book of Job, which I told you is the oldest book in the Bible. So here we have a guy that's, we're talking almost 6,000 years ago, this book was written, and this young man says this: I have been taught that there's a spirit inside of man, and it's the inspiration of the Almighty God inside the spirit that gives us understanding and answers. It is God who wants to inspire you. As moving as all of those pictures were we just saw, and they definitely were moving. I mean, I helped to edit the video, and I thought it was awesome watching it again. Moving. I mean, you cannot watch that without being awe-inspired. So we seem, but we're all moved in emotion. And what we need to do is be able to identify, where did it come from? Where did those dolphins come from? Where did those cliffs come from? Who formed all of this? The Creator, to point you to Him, so that when you're pointed to Him, He can now bring inspiration on the inside of you. We said this, 2 Chronicles chapter 16 and verse 9, that the eyes of the Lord search back and forth across the whole earth, looking for people who are totally committed to Him. You say, how do I get God to inspire me? How do I get Him as Elihu knew back almost 6,000 years ago? How do I get God to enlighten my spirit man, that third part of me? You be totally committed to Him. You see, the eyes of the Lord are looking back and forth across the whole earth, looking for people who are totally committed. But what's on the other side of that comma is really what gets me excited. So that He can show His great power by inspiring them and helping them. How many of you would love for God to show His great power on your behalf to inspire you and to help you? I'm telling you, let me tell you something that will inspire you when God helps you. Has anybody ever in here been able to identify a moment in your life when God helped you? Anybody in here? And how many of you know that was a pretty inspirational moment? And you were like, are you serious, God? Did you just do that for me? And the problem is, you know you, and you know you didn't deserve what He did. And because you didn't deserve what He did, it's really inspiring. That's how good our God is. It's not based on deserve. It's based on commitment. My wife, I'm committed to her. She's committed to me. I don't deserve her, and she definitely doesn't deserve me. That was the only way I could make that sentence finish, so I was like, what am I going to say now? All the men should be like, yeah, baby. They knew better. You're going to have a better afternoon than me. No, we're committed to one another. That commitment goes beyond the other. The problems, the arguing, the disagreement, or just agreeing to disagree, our commitment goes beyond all of that. So it's not your perfection that causes God to move on your behalf. I don't know if you were glad for that. I don't know if you got some good news just now. It's not your perfection that causes God to move on your behalf. It's your commitment. I'm committed to you, God, so he's going to show you his power. We talked about the last book of the Bible, Malachi, which was written, you know, after a 4,000-year period from Genesis or Job to Malachi. We're talking about a 4,000-year period before Jesus comes on the scene. And that was the last book of the Old Testament, and we shared this last week, that when that book closed, chronologically, it's the last book written. When that book closed with the last verse of Scripture, we don't hear from God or his inspiration or his voice for 400 years from the time that book closed in the Old Testament to that spread to the what we call the New Testament. The first words that rang out from heaven were from Luke chapter 2, verse 14. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill towards men. The angel spoke after 400 years. God has sealed his lips because he had been working on a plan. Now, he wasn't working on it during that 400 years. The Bible says from the foundations of the earth, before the earth was ever created, he knew what he was going to do. He knew man was going to fail before they failed. He had already created. He's Jehovah Jireh. He goes ahead. Let me just give you a good picture of God. God sits in the center of time. And when God needs to remind himself, he can go all the way back to the beginning and he can relive the moment of creation and remind himself creation. He can go all the way back to when Elihu wrote down those words and said, I know that there's a spirit inside of man. He can go back to that time and he can see that. He can go back to the time of King David and he can look at Israel at its might, strength, and power. He can also fast forward to the book of Malachi and he can see when that book was written. God sits in the center of time. He can also fast forward and remind himself at the cross. Anytime he needs to remind himself how much he loves mankind, he can look at the cross over and over and over. He can relive that. Just like if you were to buy the DVD, The Passion, and you sat there and played it over and over again, but God can see the actual moment and replay it over and over and over. He can go as far back as he needs to, and he can go, listen, as far forward. Which means he can fast forward to this very moment before we ever got here and make a plan for you. But not only that, he can go into your future, and he can plant seeds ahead of you before you ever get there. This is what our God is all about. So he makes a plan through Jesus Christ before it ever came about. 400 years of silence happens. The angels ring out his plan. Glory to God in the highest. Who's he talking about? The creator, the intelligent one, the one who's put the plan together on earth. How many of you live on earth? Any earthlings in here? Come on. If you don't raise your hand, you're an illegal alien. I shouldn't have gone there. On earth, peace. Forgive me, Jesus. On earth, and peace and goodwill to men. These are the words that ring out. Silence. God says, I've got a plan. In heaven, they're worshiping me. On earth, I've got a plan. Peace and goodwill towards men. The next thing we see, 30 years from that moment, we fast forward, we see John the Baptist. He's down in the river baptizing. All of Jerusalem is stirred up by this guy's ministry. They're saying, who is this guy, John the Baptist? What's going on? They actually, his ministry and his speech and his speaking is so powerful that they think he's the Messiah. They go down to see him. The Bible says whole cities emptied out. There was nobody in the cities. It was like crickets. We're out there listening to John. So I want to set up real quickly how powerful John's ministry is. Very powerful. He would have been the Joel Osteen of the day. I was listening. Joel Osteen had a podcast. His podcast, it was downloaded. Are you ready for this? It was downloaded 19 million times. Feel that in this room? We can't even contemplate. 19 million people. It's like a John the Baptist. Everybody's emptying out to hear. 19 million is a drop in the bucket compared to, you understand, the earth. But here, this is what's happening. There's a voice. And it's a voice in the wilderness, and people are going out to hear it. But listen what he says when he sees Jesus. Here, this is so powerful. He sees Jesus, and he says, "Look who is coming. He is the Lamb of God, and he takes away the sins of the world." Here you have a ministry that's so powerful, and people are listening and watching and changing and being baptized and confessing their sins, and they're saying, "Are you the Messiah?" He said, "Man, I'm not even close to the Messiah. When you meet him, yo, what's up? It is going to be serious business. This guy is coming with fire." That's what he said. "This guy is coming with fire. I come with a word, but he's coming with power. He's coming with fire." And one day he looks up, and out of nowhere, Jesus crests the hill and starts walking down towards the water. He says, "Look, it's the Son of God. He's come to take away the sins of the world." John didn't even know it until that moment. Look what it says in Matthew chapter 3 and verse 16. We fast forward to the moment that now Jesus is being water baptized. That's why we provide water baptism. Jesus said we should be water baptized, and he gave us the perfect example. The Savior of the world was water baptized. And he says this: the moment Jesus came up out of the baptismal waters, the skies opened up and he saw God's Spirit. It looked like a dove descending and landing on him. And along with the Spirit, a voice: "This is my Son, chosen and marked by my love, the delight of my life." Now we see God is with us. 400 years of silence. Nothing's happening. All of a sudden, Jesus is on the scene. The Christ, the living Messiah, Yeshua, is now on the scene. John, who has got the strongest ministry at the time, millions of people, quote unquote, are watching him on television. And out comes Jesus. He walks onto the scene, and they're going, "This guy's awesome. John, he's it." And then he says, "I'm nobody. The one who's it just showed up." And listen to this. The one who's it submits to water baptism. And John even said to him, do you remember what John said? "I need to be baptized by you." And Jesus said, "We're doing this because this is going to set a precedent. I'm Jehovah Jireh. I'm looking ahead at people, and they need to see that I submitted to the very thing I'm asking them to submit to." Jesus told us in John 14, 16 that he was going to talk to the Father, because he was going to the cross, he was going to die, he was going in the grave, he was going to rise from the dead, he was then going to go to heaven. He wasn't going to be on the earth anymore, which was disappointing to his disciples. Jesus said, "I'm going to talk to the Father when I get up there. And he's going to provide you someone else who's just like me. I will not leave you orphaned. I'm telling you these things while I'm still with you. When the Father sends the Comforter in my place, by the Comforter I mean the Holy Spirit, he will teach you and remind you of everything that I've told you." So now we see, listen, 400 years of silence, this scene of Jesus, all of a sudden he's on the scene, we hear his words, people are saying, "God's here, Emmanuel, God is with us." But Jesus say, "I'm leaving." Now, it seems as if the voice of God is leaving again, but he's got a better deal. See, God always thinks ahead. He's got a better deal. Rather than us seeking the flesh of Jesus, he says, "I'm leaving, but I'm going to go have a word with the Father. When I get up there, we're going to send the Holy Spirit, who can be on the entire globe at one time, in every city, in every town, in every home, in every bedroom, when invited. And he will come, and he will remind you of things that I've said to you." In other words, listen, God's voice is going from out here to in here. From out there to in here. See, when you get saved, God cleans you up, just like spring cleaning. Gets rid of your sin, straightens you up. That doesn't mean you won't struggle, doesn't mean you might not, you know, dabble back into that mess again, but you won't enjoy it like you used to. Go ahead, try it. No, I didn't mean that. That's not my position to tell you to go do that. But you know what I'm talking about. You go try to do something you used to do, and now you're born again. You're filled with the Spirit of God. You go try to do it. I guarantee you it'll be the most miserable experience of your life. You belly right up to that bar. You whip out as much liquor as you want, and everything that'll go down inside you, something won't be right. That's God cleans you up. He made you clean. And now he cleans you up for the very purpose. Why? Because he's getting ready to move in the Holy Spirit into your life. He's made room into your life. There's a couple things I want to point out that's happening, both in Matthew chapter 3, verse 16, which we just read about Jesus coming up out of the water, here in John chapter 14 and verse 16, where we see him talking about the Father, and then we look down in John chapter 5, verse 7, and we'll go there in 1 second. I just want to show you something. There is something happening that has never happened before in the history of the world. Prior to this, God was only known as God. He was known as Jehovah Jireh, he was known as Jehovah Rapha, he was known as a God of war, he was known as a God of peace, he was known as a God of protection, but he was not known as God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And when Jesus came on the scene and he began to declare that he was the Son of God, all of Israel was saying, "Who is this guy? God has no son. What is going on?" But if you go back and read the scriptures in the Old Testament, even Jesus points back and he says, all of the prophets were talking about me all along. They were pointing to my coming. I'm here, and because I don't look like what you think I should look like. See, that's the problem. I believe presidential races should be on radio. I don't want to know what you look like. I want to know what you have to say. I don't care. You're red, yellow, black, white, whatever. I don't care if you're striped. I mean that. It doesn't matter the race or the color. All I care about is, do you care about this country? Will you lead us and protect us? Will we have something left when my grandchildren are up in this house? By the way, I'm running for president. No, I'm looking. I'd be the worst president you've ever had. Thank you for that. Woo! Just love that guy. No. God moves in. He moves in. Why does he move in? So that you forever can have inspiration. Oh, you can watch an eagle fly, and it's pretty cool. But God created the very air that those feathers are cutting through that you can't see. That eagle, that wind, those mountains point us to where true inspiration comes from. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, never heard of this before. What we see now is a tripart God. Did you guys get that video together that I asked you to put together? Were you able to do that? So go ahead and run that while I'm talking. When we think about God, he's like an egg. And an egg is one part, but yet an egg is also three. So look at this girl. She's cracked the egg. She's removed the shell. How many of you just learned how to separate an egg really easy? You see, when you pull an egg out of the refrigerator, it's a tripart being. How many of you remember Mork and Mindy? Nanu Nanu. Remember, he grabbed the egg and he said, "Fly, be free." And it crashed on the counter. How many of you remember? That was my favorite part. "Fly, be free," and it crashed on the counter. If anybody remembers Mork and Mindy, we all need, like, surgery, you know. We're at that stage. God is a tripart being, just like an egg is one, but can be easily separated into three parts, which I thought she showed us how easy it was to separate eggs. She had a shell, she had a white, and she had a yolk. And not only that, she could put it right back in. That was a... I found that video. I'm like, this girl, she needs a show. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. God is three distinct beings, easily separated, yet described as one God. And it's at this moment that we start learning that, because we see Jesus coming up out of the water, the Holy Spirit coming as a dove, and the voice of God saying, "This is my well-beloved Son." Jesus says over in John 14, "I will talk to the Father." Jesus is going to talk to the Father, and we're going to send you the Holy Spirit. The Father and the Son are in heaven. The Holy Spirit is here on earth. It says in John chapter 1 John chapter 5 verse 7, it says, "There are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are what?" You see, the purpose of depositing the Spirit of God in you is to communicate with you. The only reason that we need a voice is to communicate. A voice is for the very purpose of communication. God did not give us a voice so we could curse. God did not give us a voice so we could jump up and down and have our way. God did not give us a voice so that we could just form our own opinion about who He is. God gave us a voice so that we could use it to further His kingdom. Communicate with people and love them. That's why He gave us a voice. So that we could be a communication system for the kingdom. Do you know every one of you is called to the ministry? Every one of you is called. I have a specific calling to stand up here and do my best to articulate a message so that you can walk out of there and say, "What was he saying? I don't know what he was saying. I don't remember. I remember the egg, but I don't remember anything else." You think I'm kidding? I'll drive down the road in my car with my kids. I'll be like, "So, how was church? It was great, Dad. What'd I preach on?" "The Bible." "Thanks for being so intuitive. Anything else? How about this one? Jesus." I mean, nothing like painting with a broad brush, right? John chapter 16, verse 5. I've got to hurry up because we took so much time up front. This is Jesus saying, "But now I'm going away to the one who sent me." Again, here we are talking tripart being. Do you see this? All of a sudden, there's all this talk about him, me, and them. We're one, but we're separate. "The fact of the matter is that it is best for you that I go away. I will provide you an advantage by sending the Holy Spirit to live in you." The disciples were sorrowful. They were upset. They were bothered that he was talking about leaving. You know, we've seen these videos of these military families when they're separated because a man goes off to war, and he goes off because he's put out somewhere for weeks or months or even years, and these families are broke up because they know he's going to do a good thing. She's going to go do a good thing. It's not that they're going to do something bad, but the separation, the anxiety of being apart is so hard, and this is what they're having, a separation anxiety. He said, "Look, I'm going back to the one who sent me, but the fact is it's going to be the best." But they're looking, going, "I don't understand it." And when a dad who's a soldier says, "Look, I'm protecting you. I'm going to this foreign nation to protect you." A little kid says, "Stay here and protect me. You can't protect me from over there." But they don't realize the implication of how big and broad the protection is really needed. We don't realize the implication, how big and broad what God did for us when He sent His Son. He went to heaven, and Jesus sent us the Holy Spirit. He said, "I'm going to provide you an advantage by sending the Holy Spirit to live in you." Where's He going to live? In you. See, He was saying, "I'm going, but you're going to have somebody in you. If I don't go, the Comforter won't come. But if I do go, I will send Him to you." And there was a reason why He wanted to send Him. He said this, "And when He has come, He will convince the world of its sin." Without the Spirit of God, there is no conviction. You'll never know right from wrong. You're really not. You could read it in the Bible and you can see, yes, this is wrong. But when you leave from the Bible, you won't act on it. But the Spirit of God at the office will say to you, you're a married man. She might be cute. She got all dressed up this morning, put on her lipstick and put on her tight little skirt. And she is walking through the office like this. And you're looking at her like, my God, isn't she fine? Let me tell you something. Just because your woman got up, she had curlers in her hair, and she was cooking your breakfast, and she was making your coffee before you went out the door, and she didn't get to brush her teeth, doesn't mean she's not fine, because that little sweet thing looked like that in the morning before she ever got to the office. Say, what was all of that?
I don't know.
No, that's the voice of God inside of you. I can't go with you to the office. Come here. I'm leaving the platform. Come here. He's all nervous because he thinks he's the one that's doing it. Just walk this way. Just walk. I can't go like this to the office. You understand? No. Don't look at her. No, that tip's not yours. Don't pick it up. Huh? What are you talking about? You've been gone for lunch for 2 hours. Get back to work.
It was a good lunch.
Okay, it was a good lunch. You see, you have the Holy Ghost on the inside of you. When you walk away from the Word, you're not always going to remember what it says. But didn't he say that he would remind you? Didn't he say that was one of the purposes of the Spirit of God on the inside of you? To convict you of sin and to remind you? I'm going back, please, all alerts down. He's going to convict the world of sin and of the availability of God's goodness. Not just of sin, but how good God is. And he's also going of deliverance from judgment. The world's sin is unbelief in me. See, we think the world's sin is cigarette smoking and drinking and carousing and, you know, looking at women. Come on. And all of, I'm only kidding. All those things that goes on, we think that's the world's sin. No, those are symptoms of a much bigger problem. Symptoms of a much bigger problem. When you're drowning in debt, debt's not the problem. There's a bigger symptom. It's called spending. And so the world's sin, look what the world's sin is. Unbelief in Jesus. You call my mama's house. She answers the phone, hello! I'm glad you called. Did you know that the sin of the world is not believing on Jesus Christ? This is how you get greeted on my mom's answering machine. I mean, if you call my mom's house, you're either going to heaven or hell. There is no in between when it comes to my mom. I'm telling you, it's one or the other, baby. No, she has got a revelation inside of her. You see, once you believe on Jesus Christ and you make him your Lord and Savior, like I said earlier, the things of the world grow strangely dim in your life, and you can't participate in those things anymore like you used to. How many of you would agree that that's true? Okay. Doesn't mean you're perfect, but you cannot participate like you used to, and the reason is he's living in you, and he's reminding you that there's judgment, but he's also letting you know that you can have deliverance from that judgment. He's also letting you, that word righteousness, that's a big word, righteousness. What does that mean? Simply this, right standing with God. I went to court one time, I'll tell this story real quick. I went to court one time, and when I went to court, I was a youth pastor, and one of the prominent families in the church, the dad was the judge in the county, one of the circuit court judges, and I had to go to court. I don't know what I did. I don't remember, but his daughter was in my youth group, and he knew me very well. I saw him every Sunday. I was the associate pastor of the church. I wore a tie and a suit. I was also the youth pastor, and he would come, and, you know, his daughter just thought I was the greatest youth pastor ever, and she even wrote a letter to herself saying she wanted to marry someone like Brother Eddie. That's what they called, you know, this is how well-known I was in this family, okay? And so I get a ticket, and I've got to go to court and take, guess who the judge is? This guy. Well, I'm the associate pastor of his church. I'm sitting in the back of the room going, oh, my Lord, this cannot be happening to me. So anyway, they go on and on and on and on. Finally, my name's Treyer, so they get to T, you know, eventually they get down there. I come up front, and I'm standing there, and it's just me and him. And he says, "Hello, Brother Eddie." I said, "Hello, Judge Kornstein," because I called him Judge Kornstein at the church. "Hello, Judge Kornstein, how are you today?" He said, "Good." He said, "What are you doing here?" As if he didn't know, you know. I said, "Well," he said, "you know, I cannot judge this case. I can't be impartial." You know why he couldn't be impartial? Because he'd have let me off. He'd have let me off because he would have showed me favor, because he knows me. You understand? So he looked at me and said, "Man, I got to adjudicate this. Someone else is going to have to judge you. I can't do this." You see, I had right standing with him. But he was a human. He couldn't get involved because he couldn't see through. When you have right standing with God, let me tell you, it's not your perfection. It's the blood of Jesus. When you stand in front of God, all he sees is this white, clean person because of the blood of Jesus. And when you come in looking all guilty, he says, "What are you doing here? What's your problem?" He says, "I don't see it." He holds up a blank piece of paper. He says, "This is all I see that's against you. There's nothing here." "Yeah, but it's all been washed away. Sorry, I can't find it. Nothing left." So, want to hear the rest of the story? So I go back to court a couple weeks later. I go before the judge. They call me up there. And he says, "Aren't you Judge Kornstein's youth pastor?" "Yes." "Okay, well, all charges dropped. Have a good day." I turned around and I looked at everybody there. We're like, I saw him at court. I mean, I saw him at church the next day. He said, "Don't say a word." He just kept walking. Come on. How do you know you've got right standing with God? You've got right standing with him. He's going to argue your case for you, not against you. And look, he put the Holy Spirit down on the inside of you to ratify his voice and to tell you, "I'm with you always. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you." And when you're serving him, he'll tell you, "You're on the right course. You're going the right way. You're doing the right thing. Keep reading the word. Keep praying. Keep going to church. Keep changing your friends. Keep finding a new path for yourself in me." But when you get off and you start doing things you shouldn't, he'll say, whoa, wait a minute. We're getting off here. Hold on a minute. No. Don't go over there. Don't go do that." You see, he's trying to keep you on course. Right? That's why this moment in time is so important. That Jesus is talking about the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. He's talking about going away, and he's talking about someone he's going to send because it's to our advantage. How many of you can see it's really to our advantage to have the Holy Spirit here versus a Jesus who's in the flesh? So he says he's going to do all of these things for us, okay? God wants to speak to you directly and distinctly. He wants to speak to you directly. Now, there is religion that I'm not against religion, but I have a relationship with God. I don't have religion. I'm not a religious person. In other words, I don't live by rules. You know, I got to get up at a certain time. I got to pray a certain hour. I got to do a certain way. I've got to do this ritual. I've got to receive this. I've got to do that. I've got to wear certain clothes. I mean, the Jews, they won't mix certain fibers and they won't, you know, they have to have kosher food. They won't have cheese on a hamburger. What's up with that? Jesus, I'm telling you, likes cheeseburgers. I'm telling you, man. I'm telling you. I was in Israel and I went to the airport and, you know, we'd been eating, you know, whatever that stuff is. And they really have a lot of great food there, but some of the stuff is ethnic, and I'm just not going to enjoy it that much. So anyway, I get to the airport, and they had a McDonald's, and I'm like, I mean, when you see the arches, it just as well be an American flag. You know what I'm saying? It's just like, I'm home. So I run to the counter at McDonald's, and I'm like, okay, I want fries, I want a Coke, and I want a cheeseburger. And they're like, we don't serve cheeseburgers. What? This is a kosher McDonald's. We don't mix cheese and burgers together. That's against our religion. I said, dude, you've got to try a cheeseburger, man. I said, it will change everything about your life. You see, religion will say, no, 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 don't, can't. Relationship says, you can do this, and you can do that, and you can do this, and the things that you can't do, you don't even care about, because what you can do is so exciting, and what God is doing for you is so open and free that you could care less about what you can't do. You're having so much fun doing what you can do that what you can't do never looks good anymore. Is my face turning red? My face turns red, let me tell you what that means. I'm preaching like Jesus because all of his words are red in the Bible. How many of you believe God wants to speak to you directly? And I was just talking about religion. You see, you can go to a certain church that's called a Christian church, but they believe that you have to go speak to the priest to get to the Father. It's not what my Bible says. I don't know what Bible they're reading. Because the Bible doesn't tell me that you have to come to me, confess your sins to me, and then I'll go to the Father on your behalf. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says you can go directly. See, God wants to speak to you directly, but then he also wants to speak to you distinctly. What does that mean? He wants to speak to you about your circumstance. You're a senior in high school. You're getting ready to make some decisions. You're getting ready to go somewhere. You're getting ready to do some things. There is a place I have for you. I want to talk to you about that. It's why I don't want you distracted. It's why I don't want you over here doing this or getting distracted by that. You need to focus on what I'm saying to you, son, because if you'll focus on what I'm saying to you, the path that I have for you is so much better than anything you can design for yourself. The voice. And then when you hear that, you're inspired. Okay, I'm going to read one more scripture, then I'm going to give you another definition, and I'm going to wrap up. You see, God wants to inspire you with his own voice, not somebody else's. I read somewhere when I was studying this that someone said, you want to know the voice of God? Well, if you must know, it's Aretha Franklin's. Now, I can't help it. That woman can't get no respect. And she might have a good set of pipes, but those pipes were put in there by an intelligent designer. And I realize it was a joke, but my point is this. Some people are looking in the wrong place for the voice of God. Hindu religion believes there's over 300,000 gods. 300,000 gods. They believe in 300,000. They can't even name all their gods. And that's why they don't want to kill animals and stuff, because that could be their god or it could be their relative. Man, if that were true, I'd be stepping on every cockroach. What are you doing back here? I heard a joke one time. Somebody said that the mom was telling the daughter that God had created them wonderfully and after his image, and that he created them so perfectly, and that they were perfectly created by God and all of this, you know. And then the daughter went to the dad, and the dad started saying that they were created from monkeys, and that they came from, you know, evolution and all of that, not from creation. And so the daughter went back to the mom and said, well, mom, dad says that, you know, you say we came from God, but dad says we came from monkeys. She said, well, honey, I was telling you about my side of the family, and the dad was telling you about his side of the family. In other words, people are looking in the wrong places. Let me wrap this up. You getting anything out of this morning? 1 Kings chapter 19 and verse 11. 1 Kings 19 and 11. This is Elijah. He's being chased down by King Ahab's wife, Jezebel, because Elijah has stirred some things up. I talked about Elijah in that he said that he stood before God. If you remember, we talked about that last week. He's now running from the king and his wife, and he's hiding in a mountain, and God comes to visit him in the cave. And he says, "What are you doing here, Elijah? Why are you hiding?" He said, "Because I'm afraid for my life." He said, "Besides that, I'm the only one left who's serving you." And so God says this, "Go out and stand before me on the mountain." The Lord told him, and Elijah stood there, and the Lord passed by, and a mighty windstorm hit the mountain. It was such a terrible blast that these rocks were torn loose. But when the Lord was not in the wind, after the wind there was an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake there was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. After the fire there was the sound of a gentle whisper, and Elijah heard it. Again, looking in the wrong place for God's voice. They once asked Jesus, they said to him, "If you'll show us the kingdom, we'll be satisfied that you're the Son of God." They wanted to see an actual address. They wanted to be marched down into a city and say, "Well, here's my kingdom," because that's all man can understand. And Jesus said to them these words, "The kingdom of God is within you." So if you want to know the address of God, it's right here. Because he sent the Holy Spirit to live in you. Quit looking for him in all of these things. Listen for him to speak to you. Because he will. This is where inspiration comes from. Let me give you another definition of inspiration or inspired. I read the definition that I had, which was from a recent edition of the Webster's Dictionary. Somebody in the church went home and had an 1831 edition of the Webster's Dictionary. They took that dictionary and they sent me this from Webster's dictionary from the early 1800s. Listen. "The infusion of ideas into the mind by the Holy Spirit. The conveying into the minds of men ideas, notices, or motions by extraordinary or supernatural influence, or the communication of the divine will to the understanding by suggestions or impressions on the mind," listen to the last part, "which leave no room for doubt that the reality of a supernatural origin." Jesus said this, "My sheep know my voice." Stand up with me, church. "My sheep know my voice." He went on to say, "Another voice they will not follow." My whole purpose in this message, this series, and let me say this, last week and this week was just an introduction. You come back next week and we're going to talk about how to hear the voice of God. We're going to talk about what the Bible says. We're going to go into the epistles. We've been over in the Old Testament and we have been in the Gospels, but we're going to get over into the letters that were written to the church, where Paul begins to talk about how the voice of God works. We're going to see examples of the New Testament church having the voice of God within them. These examples were set so you and I can follow them. Let me say this to you, the number one thing that has to happen in your life for any of this, what I'm talking about, to happen is you have to commit yourself to Christ first. He died for you. He moved first, came to earth, lived, and died. Then he said, those that believe on me, I will endue them with the Spirit. Every head bowed and every eye closed, let's take a moment here. Look inside yourself. I know I've gone a little long this morning, and I apologize for that. I want you to look inside yourself and say, have I made a commitment to Jesus Christ? Have I used my vocal cords and committed my life? Not, I prayed with other people, but I didn't mean it from my heart. No, I meant it from my heart. If you're in this room today and you've never committed your life to Jesus Christ, the Bible says there's only one way to serve Christ and to make heaven. It's through a commitment. And you have to make that commitment verbally. And the Bible says you have to believe it in your heart and say it with your mouth. That's the only instructions we have. So it's the only instructions I can give you. The Bible says when you do that, that you're saved, you're forgiven, you're redeemed, and you're ready for heaven. There's a second invitation. Maybe someone's in here, you have made that commitment before, but you know you're not serving God like you should be right now. You've broken commitment with God. This is an opportunity for you to come back. What I'm going to do is I'm going to count to three. I'm going to snap my fingers, and when you do, the only reason I'm snapping my fingers is to give you an opportunity to respond at that moment. One, don't let this moment go by. Two, you say, I've got to make this commitment or recommitment. Three, just throw your hand up right now. Say, that's me. Thank you for that hand. God bless you. Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. Somebody else. Somebody else. Somebody else. Say, I wish I'd have lifted my hand. This is your moment right here, right now. Christians are praying. Nobody's looking around. Thank you for that hand. God bless you. Thank you for that hand over there. God bless you. One more time, I'm going to look across this audience, and I need to move to another portion of this ministry time. Come on. Somebody else, we don't want to move until you've responded. If you need to respond, this is your time, your moment, your committed time. Up in the mezzanine. Thank God for those that lifted their hands. You're important. You're valuable. This is a life-changing moment. Everything stops for one person on the earth because the eyes of the Lord run to and fro to show himself powerful on behalf of one person. What we're going to do is we're going to pray a prayer. Everybody's going to pray this prayer out loud, but I'd like you to also pray this prayer out loud if you lifted your hand so you can hear yourself and make this commitment. Everyone say this. Heavenly Father, I right now confess my need for a Savior, and I realize without you, I'm lost. I confess my sin, and I realize that I'm lost. But I know that in you, I can be forgiven. So I ask you to forgive me of my sins, all my failures, shortcomings, the ones I know about, the ones that I did not even knowing. I believe your blood is strong enough to wash away my past, and that your word is bright enough to give me a new future. I confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and I invite you now to come into my heart, to change my life. I say from this day forward, I will never be the same. I'm forever changed. I'm born again. I am a Christian, and I look forward to tomorrow living in you. Can you say amen, church, and give God some praise in this house? If you prayed that prayer, we believe you got born again. We believe that you're changed, forever changed. It doesn't matter if the skies opened up, if you began to shake, whether you're weeping or you're not weeping. That is not it. It's a commitment to Jesus Christ. Don't worry about what you're not supposed to do. Now study what you're supposed to do. And the other will grow dim. It'll just go away from you. The other's religion. This is relationship. What we're going to do right now is we're going to make a little shift in the service. We're going to invite our prayer team to come forward. If you would like prayer for anything, for any reason, we have people up front qualified to pray with you. The other thing we're going to do is if you'd like to be water baptized, we've already spoken about that. You probably read it in the card. We had a lady come last night who was water baptized. It was absolutely powerful. She had thought about it all day and couldn't wait to get here last night to be water baptized. Brand new to the church, not been coming that long. It was an awesome moment. If you'd like to participate in that, I know we've gone a little late, but we're going to always offer salvation and we're always going to offer water baptism. We do our best to keep that clock right, but the service goes over, it goes over a little bit. And we know it went over because I made the announcements. I take full responsibility for what happened. Pastor Tony will be back next week and we'll be back in order. On either two of those things. Need prayer? Come on, prayer team, where are you? I'm waiting on you. Water baptism. If you want water baptism, go to the back of the room now. If you want prayer, you can come forward now. If you lifted your hand to get born again in this room, someone's going to come talk to you. They're going to pray for you, and they're going to give you a packet as we begin to worship in here. Let me say this. Because we've gone over, the service is kind of officially dismissed, so if you need to slip out, that's fine. You go ahead and slip out, but please do so respectfully of what's happening in this room. If you want to stay and worship, you can just spend a few minutes here and worship God. Thank you, Jesus. Let's go ahead and close our eyes. Let's go ahead and make that transition right here and begin to pour our hearts out. Let's just take a few minutes, church. We won't hold you very long, I promise you. Let's pour our hearts out in this place this morning. Hallelujah.
The moon and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dim. The Savior of the world was falling. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon him. Heaven looked away, the Son of God was made in darkness, a battle in the grave, the war on death was waged, the power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake, the stone was rolled away, his perfect love could not be overthrown. Now there is darkness, our resurrected King has rendered you defeated forever.
sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. Oh, come on, every voice today.
From the dead, and that's exactly what we do outwardly with water baptism. You see, that born-again experience means that we were dead inside spiritually, and then Christ comes on the inside of us, and like a light sets off an explosion on the inside of us and brings us alive spiritually, and we've talked about that this morning and in the past. But baptism is this representation of what happened on the inside, that death that goes this way, and as we come up, that life that comes on the inside of us, this is a resurrection moment. And to be honest with you, this is a little bit of a special moment for me personally, because these are my neighbors. And for me, they are a symbol of what God is doing at Family Worship Center. And for all these years, we've been friends and, you know, talked here and there. But as far as a deep relationship, we haven't had that. But God set up this moment in time where their hearts were seeking for more. And we just happened to be here. So for me, it's just a symbol that God is wanting to reach your neighbors. Come on, God's wanting to reach your neighbors. I'm just so thrilled. So this is Cindy. So how long have you been coming now, Cindy? 5 weeks. She actually asked me to come across the street and look at the back of her house for some architecture ideas. And so we were talking about that, and I told her that I would help her with some ideas on her home. And then as we walked up the driveway, she said, matter of fact, I was walking away, and you stopped me and said, hey, can I ask you a question? And we started talking about church, and she asked me what it was like to come to Family Worship Center. And I was able to tell her, you come as you are, I think you'll enjoy it. Then she let me in on a little secret. I've been watching you online. She's pretty slick, I'll tell you that. She worked me pretty good there. So it's just I feel like this is family. feel like this is a family moment, because see, your family's not always the family that your blood runs together. It's the family God brings together. So Cindy, this is an honor. If you'll just hold your hands up over your face, Cindy, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, and in the wonderful and masterful name of Jesus. Never the same. Forever changed. Whispered to me, that's my sister. I already know that. Looking at you, if you're not sisters, then we're just say you look a lot alike. This is Peggy. I'm not sharing that. She let me know who was older, and I'm not going to share. But you realize that if she shared, probably you know the truth. Well, being the youngest of nine, you know, I always get to hold out. So how long have you lived across the street? 4 years. So she lives in the home with Cindy and her husband. She occupies the downstairs. And I was going to say, what's been interesting about them coming to church is that once they started coming, they've come to every stinking service we've had. They come Saturday night, Sunday morning, Wednesday night, Saturday night, Sunday morning, Wednesday. I mean, they're just here. And they've been coming long enough. Did you make this decision today, or is this something you've been talking about? You did this 40 years ago, so you're rededicating yourself. How about your sister? I should have asked her. This is her first time. Was this a decision you all made today to make this decision together, standing here today? She made you come. Come on, this is a good sister that'll go, huh? That's awesome. Said she loves it here and she wants to be here. I'm so glad. Well, let's do this thing. Peggy, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, and in the wonderful and masterful, precious, redeeming name of Jesus.
Your presence is
Church. We are so glad you were here this morning. And if you were a first time, if you're a first time today, please stop by the Welcome Center, get that free gift they have for you. Before you head out, I have one quick reminder, our 21 days of prayer. When you head outside here, we have cards that have the prayer schedule on them. So as you head out, please grab that so you can mark that on pen, or if you're up in the 21st century, you can put it on your tablet and all that cool stuff that y'all have. So please do that. Y'all have a wonderful afternoon. We'll see you later.